Good afternoon, ladies. I'm so happy to be joining you today in going through a series with you, The Crucible. And I know you're on your third week, and we are going to be on the topic of circumstances versus truth. Before we start, why don't we pray? Father in heaven, thank you for allowing us to study your word together this afternoon. And I pray that you will speak to each and every woman here and meet her at her level of need. I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. So we are on the third, as I said, your series, and it was such a blessing for me to prepare for you. So I hope you will be blessed as well. Every day, we make decisions, and it's so timely because the decisions we make today are so important, especially during times like this. But how can we have peace about the decisions we are making? How do we know that it is the right one? Is it safe to say that if something is presented before you, seemingly like a blessing or a miracle, that automatically that is the door that God wants you to go through? Let's find out from the Word of God how to make wise and godly decisions. We're going to be looking at 1 Samuel chapter 24 into the life of David and Saul, and we're going to investigate what was it about David and how did he make his choices. Let's read. The verses are there for us to read. Let's read together. He came to the sheep pens along the way. A cave was there, and Saul went in to relieve himself. David and his men were far back in the cave. Then the men said, "This is the day that the Lord spoke of when he said, 'To you I will give your enemy into your hands for you to deal with as you wish.'" Then David crept up unnoticed and cut off the corner of Saul's robe. Afterward, David was conscience-stricken for having cut off a corner of his robe. He said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, or lay my hand on him, for he is the anointed of the Lord." With these words, David sharply rebuked his men and did not allow them to attack Saul. And Saul left the cave and went away. Let's go to verses 11 to 12. "See, my father," he's speaking to Saul now from afar, "look at this piece of your robe in my hand. I cut off the corner of your robe, but did not kill you. See, there is nothing in my hand to indicate that I am guilty of wrongdoing or rebellion. I have not wronged you, but you are hunting me down to take my life. May the Lord judge between you and me, and may the Lord avenge the wrongdoings you have done to me. But my hand will not touch you." So we see the first scenario given to David in order for him to decide which way to take. Let's go to the second scenario, and we'll look at it further as we move on. 1 Samuel chapter 26, verses 7 to 12. "So David and Abishai went to the army by night, and there was Saul lying asleep inside the camp, and his spear stuck in the ground near his head, and Abner and the soldiers lying around him. And Abishai said to David, 'Today God has delivered your enemy into your hands. Now let me pin him down to the ground with one thrust of the spear. I won't strike him twice.' But David said to Abishai, 'Don't destroy him. Who can lay a hand on the Lord's anointed and be guiltless? As surely as the Lord lives,' he says, 'the Lord himself will strike him, or his time will come and he will die, or he will go into battle and perish. But the Lord forbid that I should lay a hand on the Lord's anointed. Now get the spear and water jug that are near his head and let's go.' So David took the spear and water jug near Saul's head and they left. No one saw or knew about it, nor did anyone wake up. They were all sleeping because the Lord had put them to deep sleep." What a story. So if we look closely at the two situations in chapter 24 and 26, we may come to the conclusion that since the circumstances were so ideal and were arranged in such a way that Saul, who was David's tormentor and hindrance to his being king, was right there in front of him, wasn't it a clear sign and a go-ahead from God to kill him? We must first look and take close consideration that God clearly said in scripture years before that David would be king. And look at the promise of God here. In 1 Samuel 16:1, let's read it. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn that Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse in Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king." How clear, right? So let's look at verse 11. So he asked Jesse, "Are these all your sons you have?" "There is still the youngest," Jesse answered, "but he is tending sheep." Samuel said, "Send for him. We will not sit down until he arrives." Verse 12. So he sent and had him brought in. He was ruddy, with a fine appearance and handsome features. Then the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him. He is the one." Clearly, we see how God had chosen David, how God had in his big plan that David would be the chosen king, the anointed one. In fact, this is chapter 16. So tell me, in the circumstances we are presented with, tell me, because I have this question, what is the role then of circumstances in our life? Have you thought of that? But think this through. Circumstances that happen around you and me are changing all the time. And they are affected by other situations and other people that are around us. Yes, of course, God can use and orchestrate circumstances in our lives to guide us one way or the other. However, circumstances will always need to be aligned with the truth in God's Word. They alone will never be a sure indication that that is God's divine direction. I repeat, circumstances alone will never be a sure indication that that is God's divine direction. When something presents itself before you, be it a situation, a person, or an offer, and it seems to be very positive, and even you sometimes call it miraculous or a blessing, this does not, again, indicate an open door for you to automatically enter. Everything must be filtered, must be checked against the Word of God, His truth. There are two things about God that we always need to keep in the top of our mind and constantly consider, and that is the character of God, His character, and His Word, those two. Because those two will never contradict. And when faced with a decision that you need to make, you need to put those two in line with the offer before you. Remember, His promises, even His promises, will also be based on who He is and what His Word says. Remember that. That's very important. So in the case of David, it was clear that God promised David the throne. We read that. But he never said when he would do it or how it would happen, because that's God's business. Remember, God's promises will be fulfilled His way and not ours. And His promises are always going to be based on His timetable and not mine or yours. Think about that. So why are there circumstances then that seem positive and even sound like a blessing? Think about it. Why does God even allow it? Why confuse us, right? I have realized that after going through the Word of God, reading through it, studying the Psalms, you know, just enjoying Scripture and the stories, God's ultimate purpose in making us wait is because He knows that there is much for me and you to learn. He wants us to learn in the waiting. More than giving us His promise, He is more concerned with preparing us character-wise to be good stewards of His promise and of His blessings. His ways and timing caused David to grow, to mature, and to prepare him for the fulfillment of the promise and his role, David's role, in the promise. David had to learn how to wait on the Lord. Not just wait, but how to wait on the Lord. What do I mean? While waiting, David learned how to be a listener. He learned to listen intently to God. He learned how to lean on Him, depend on Him when times seemed hopeless. David had to seek God's wisdom and guidance during circumstances that were troubling and stressful in his life. There will always be a reason for God's seeming delay. I say seeming because to man, it may seem to be a delay, but to God, it never is. Because God's timing is always perfect. We always want to get to the point, right? To the point wherein we find the answer to our prayer. We always want to get the fulfillment of the promise in the shortest time possible. And if possible, Lord, the easiest way, don't we? However, God is wiser than we are, over and above our thoughts. He is. Remember this principle. His intention is not to get us to the destination alone, but to prepare us for it. Why bring us there if we won't know how to handle it, right? Look at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you as though something strange was happening to you. Look at the verse. It says, there will be ordeals, then don't be surprised, but it is there to test you. What do you mean by that? To see. What choices will you make? How are you going to respond? How will you react? In fact, in the life of Joseph, it was said in Psalm 105, verse 19, God tested Joseph until it came to pass. So you see, God was testing Joseph while waiting until it came to pass. When circumstances draw us towards one direction and God's truth draws us towards the opposite, remember, God's truth always will prevail over the circumstance. Imagine a woman, true story, just talk to me, that she incurred a large debt before COVID because she opened her store and she invested in so much stocks. But you see, it suddenly closed. God knew it would, but she didn't, right? But she closed it and she bought stocks on credit. So now she's being hounded by her creditors and she owes them a lot of money. She has 4 kids to raise. But what did she do before COVID? She decided to go abroad because she said it would give her more income. And it wasn't even that much. Today, she calls me after listening to the Sunday message about no regrets on money. She called me through a messenger service and said she's in debt. She's far away from her family. She's still incurring debt and she can't pay it. So what are we saying here? Remember, God never contradicts himself. He won't ask you to leave if you are a mother with young children. He will be your provider. The question to ask is, how does this look from the entire plan of God for me? How does this look from the character of God? So what am I going to do moving forward? Moving forward, what are we going to do? As I seek to make decisions I am faced, how will I look at it in my life? Think of David in chapter 24, when he was faced with a possibility of killing Saul, and even if his men said it's a good time, God said it, he said no. God's bigger plan is I don't kill. And that in the end, if God chooses to kill him his way, in battle or old age, whatever, only God could do it, but I will not manipulate the situation. Such was David. And then when he was presented with another scenario, in camp, the king was asleep. So were the soldiers around him. And David could have easily killed him. Even his servant Abishai offered to do it with one sword. David said no. He is the anointed of the Lord. You see, David always looked at God's plan. He knew that even if the king was unreasonable, even if the situation was bad, and even if he was running for his life, God was still over all. So, what are the biblical guidelines? What biblical guidelines should I do to be informed about my decision? Proverbs 2 verse 6 says, "For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding." Always seek the wisdom of God. First and foremost, before you seek the wisdom of man or others or even people who are experts, go to God, seek his word. Know what he says about the topic. And remember, cover it with prayer. Always the word and prayer, prayer and the word. Go back and forth. One verse that stuck with me even in my single days since I was a solo mom was Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not in your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Why do I love this verse? First of all, ladies, I know that our hearts are filled with trouble, and our hearts are leaning towards certain things and desires. And so is our understanding. You know, when we get information, we think we know better than anyone else. So God's saying, trust in Him alone, in all your heart, meaning remove all what's in your heart, remove what's all in your mind. Trust Him, and He will make your path straight. Always check your heart. Are you God-motivated, or are you self-motivated? Are you interested in the things of God, or are you interested in the things for yourself? Matthew 6:33, we just studied this verse yesterday. But seek first the kingdom of God and all His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. When we are faced with a certain issue or a choice, remember, God's kingdom comes first. Always ask, will my decision bring glory to the kingdom of God? Will it bring glory to His name? Or will it cause others to stumble? They know I'm a Christian. And if I choose this, what will it say about my God? In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, so whether you eat or drink, and whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. What an amazing verse. It starts with something so minimum, eat or drink. But then it covers it all, sums it up, and says, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. How? How then? Will that decision affect your walk? How will it affect the intimacy you have with God? That's another question to ask. Will this decision cause me to walk further from God or towards God? I am giving you so much scripture because we are talking about circumstances versus truth. And scripture is truth. Nothing changes scripture. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Remember, your choice will cause people to fall away or to walk with God. So will my choice cause me to break God's command? There are always commandments in the Bible that are specific and some are general, but you need to refer to the Word of God. I have used this filter. I call it my biblical filter. It's Philippians 4:8. And when I make a choice, I'm putting it in the screen for you, I always go through this. In other words, although you can read it as a verse, this is how I think through it. Will my decision be true of my faith? Be the truth? Or is it, you know, a lie? Is it honorable? Is it right? Is it pure? Is it lovely? Is it of good repute? Is it an excellent choice? In other words, will it bring praises to my God? After checking through this filter of God's Word, I then begin to align the possible choices with God's character as well. When you have a choice, and then you want to seek God's Word, then do it first in God's Word, and then after, and only after much prayer, and you still need more advice, then you seek the counsel of godly people. But remember, bring all the facts to the table. Do you have all the facts? Or are you being pressured by time? Is somebody forcing you to make a decision prematurely? Proverbs 21:5 says, the plans of the diligent lead surely to an advantage, but everyone who is hasty surely comes to poverty. I myself have made many hasty decisions and has led me to poverty. Honestly, it has happened to my family, but then now I refer to God and His Word. Get godly counsel and weigh them against God's Word. Even if it's from me, I want you to weigh it against God's Word. Why? Because Proverbs 11:14 says, where there is no guidance, the people fall. But in the abundance of counselors, there is victory. Share your choices and facts honestly. Lay it in front of the person giving you counsel so he can make a wise decision in terms of what he's going to advise you. Have you considered the possible consequences of your choice? That's another thought. Every choice has a consequence. And so, have you considered all the consequences? My dad used to teach me to do the pros and cons in a column and make sure that I have written down the possible scenarios or consequences. Think of it. How will it affect God, your relationship with Him? How will it affect your relationship with your family, your children? How will it affect their walk, your walk, their testimony, your testimony, and the testimony of who God is in your life. All that, write it down. And could this decision jeopardize my integrity or hinder my witness for the Lord? Much to think about, and much more. Look at Proverbs 10:9. He who walks in integrity walks securely, but he who perverts his ways will be found out. Think about this. What story is God writing in your life? What is he writing in my life? The life we live is now going to be his story, our history, our legacy. Think about it. What legacy will you leave behind? Lastly, and I put this together, never assume that just because something is hard, that it is not God's will. In much the same way, never assume that just because it seems like a miracle or a blessing, and it seems easy, that it is God's will for you. Weigh everything closely. In closing, think about David again. Let's go back to David. Twice, he had a chance. He was given the opportunity right there in front of him to end the life of Saul, to actually take things into his own hands. But you see, he referred back to the promise of God, that even if the promise was about him being king, obviously God had a divine plan. The divine plan was unseen to David, but seen by God. And he, even if he had two great opportunities, he decided that God would do everything in his time and in his way, not David's. What is it about David? What is it about his relationship with God that we can copy, that we can also emulate? Both times, he did refer to the fact that Saul was God's choice and anointed for that moment. And he believed that God's larger plan was bigger than his. Why? Because he experienced God. Because he leaned on God. He waited on God. He listened to God. He was growing in his waiting, even in his agony in the desert. He believed that God would be the only one to decide when and how Saul's reign would end. He knew that God was in total control. He trusted in his perfect timing, his perfect way, and never relied on the situations before him. He embraced the hardships and saw that his decisions would reflect on the character of God and the story of David's life. He was willing to trust in God and to learn his lessons along the way. And at the right time, he knew that when God said he would be king, nothing could stop God, and David would be king. And indeed, David became king. So ladies, I hope you were encouraged to remember, to reflect on God's character, to review God's word, meditate on it, and to cover your decisions with much prayer and counsel, because God alone knows the entire plan of your life. And remember, this plan is to prosper you and not to destroy you, to give you hope and a future. Thank you, ladies, for spending this afternoon with me, and have a blessed time of discussion as you reflect on God's word together. Thank you for having me.